Good morning.
Good morning. What day is it, Audrey?
September 13th, 2022. You are here with Mortgage Pros 411, Kevin Casey, and yours truly. We have our wonderful guest, Barry Habib, and Megan Anderson's joining us. That's a nice surprise. How's everything in New Jersey?
Jersey's good. It's good. Yeah. I think Megan, too, spends a lot of time in Florida. I spend a lot of time in Florida as well, but it's nice to be here. This is a nice time of year to be here.
Is it? Yeah. Is it annoying when people go to New Jersey, just like it's annoying when people say Frisco or NorCal?
Nobody in New Jersey says New Jersey. So
Exactly. Nobody in Northern California says NorCal. Nobody in Northern California says Frisco. So that's why I was asking. All right. Well, good morning, everyone. People are, you know, LOs trickle in. So we're going to get this going. Let's start with a couple of announcements. There are some events going on this week. September 15th, that's Thursday. You can learn all about the IRS in Rancho Cucamonga from 11:30 to 1 p.m. And you can go to Top Golf in El Segundo from 5 to 8 p.m. on Thursday. And can I just tell you something? I watched the video on Top Golf. To say that I am not a golfer is a massive understatement. But even I would go to this because it's fun. There's a lot of drinking. Yeah, there's music. Right, you can hang out. So don't let the golf part of the equation get to you. Join them. Go get out of your house. Go do something fun. Yeah?
I'm sure there's alcohol involved.
Oh, yeah, thing. It's the mortgage industry. Of course, there's alcohol involved. All right. So moving right along, on October 13th and November 17th, there is online in MLS with yours truly. And that is, yeah. So if you haven't done your NMLS, for God's sake, get on it.
You forgot about the 21st. It's coming up next week.
Oh, good God. Yeah. We're going to be in Southern California teaching NMLS. What the heck? Ventura, where?
Yeah, Ventura, Greater Ventura. I believe it's Oxnard, but...
okay, whatever.
Go to Greater Ventura Camp's website.
For God's sake. Or just email me and I'll actually respond and figure it out too. So there you go. Harry texted to say that Topgolf was Frisco. Oh, Frisco. He's talking about the Frisco thing. Okay, so moving right along. So we had a little event last week. Somebody decided it was a good time to raise the conforming loan limits. Yeah. So 7:15. And by the way, this is not the official raising of the loan limits. Somehow there are some people in our industry who think that Thanksgiving just isn't soon enough. So let's just try to preempt the GSEs and raise them ahead of time. So for the most part, we're seeing a lot of people who are jumping on board with this. So just check your lender, see what their position is on this. A lot of the retailers, a lot of the wholesalers are doing the 7:15 loan limits.
I think that makes a lot of sense, actually, because I know you don't, but I think it makes sense because they're predicting what the limit will be. They usually come under when they do the prediction, and it's just in time. If you do the loan start today, you close it, they sell it right as the new limits come out. So it's brilliant, actually.
Whatever. I was just concerned about them being able to sell it on the back end. And when PennyMac jumped in and said, yeah, we'll buy them. And there's some other place did the same thing. I was like, all right, as long as everyone's safe. I always worry about the secondary market these days. And also the MI companies, for the most part, are on board the new loan limits. The ones who are not quite there are working on it. So you should be okay with MI, but make sure you're checking to make sure that you are working with the MI companies who are ready to go with this. In other news.
Yeah, look at that.
That's right. So I think I told you this a few times. We had a little group that we collected of people who had bought the Certified Mortgage Advisor course during 2020 or 21 or whenever the heck it was. And it was sitting there. Now I knew I'd open the box because periodically I'd see my son wearing the shirt that said Certified Mortgage Advisor. And I'd go, that's interesting. I don't even remember giving it to him, but I did. Now I remember. Anyway, it was a great course. So we had a few of us. So Jill's chiming in here. She did it. Kathy Durangi did it. Kelly Adcock got hers. I mean, and then at the end, guess what you get? The certificate and a box full of other goodies. It was really great. Mm-hmm. But more importantly, you get a real overview of what is being spoken about every morning when you are listening to Barry, Megan, and the crew at MBS Highway. So Dawn Seichner's chiming in. She has hers. Of course she does. She's an overachiever too. Anyway, it was a great course. We loved it. If you put a gun to my head and said, all right, tell me what a golden cross looks like, I would be dead. But at least I have a much clearer idea and I can build on that, right? So
yeah.
Thank you guys. It's great. It's really nice to have those resources. And we keep saying that now is the time to up our game. Now is the time. It's always the time, but now you have time. So get out there and do something. Get certifications, learn something new, tune in. Yeah.
Yes. I'm so proud of you, Audrey, and proud of everyone on this call. I love that you guys created this little accountability group and you guys got through it. And, you know, as you said, now is such a great time. As things are slowing down a little bit, it is time for us to improve our skills, not to stay stuck in this negative mindset, but to find the opportunity and realize that these times are simply there for us again to sharpen our tools. So, you know, Barry will talk about it a little bit, but, you know, if you guys have any questions regarding CMA, you want an overview, you can ask me, you can ask Audrey, you can ask Barry, you can ask all of us. So we're all here for you.
Well, we're having Megan come join us this Thursday, our little group, just to go over a few of the things that we weren't entirely clear on. And again, this is the beginning. It's not the end of learning. It's not the end of the process. And again, I want to be able to talk about charts like Barry does, where he's like, oh yeah, and it's so easy. And it's this. I mean, it's unbelievable what he sees that the rest of us don't see. So Barry, let's hear from you.
Hey guys, how are you? Congratulations, Audrey and Kevin. It's really great to be with you. And I am happy, Megan, that you're on this with me today. So hope everyone's doing well. I know that these times are different, of course, than what we've been accustomed to the last couple of years. But, you know, there was a lot of complaining the last couple of years, too, about different things, right? So we just moved from one environment to another. What we have to do in every environment is try to be the very best we can and to capitalize on that. So I know that some of you right now have some real concerns. And I know that some of you right now might be worried and wondering, okay, well, refinances are, you know, a little bit few and far between. And then you take a look on the purchase side and it's become much more competitive. Depending on where you're placing your loans, there could be some very aggressive pricing some places that you may or may not have access to. You know, obviously that's a temporary thing. So you know, you're in a situation where, you know, what happens after that, or, you know, where are these buyers going when the media is talking about a housing crash and people are normally would have been interested, get poisoned by what's happening there. And they say, hey, wait a minute, maybe I shouldn't purchase a home. It might leave you questioning, you know, what your future might look like. Okay. I'm not saying that's for everybody, but certainly for some people, at least what I hear and talk to, that's.
Yeah. That's we're seeing there. A lot of fallouts when they go into contract and the next thing.
I'm talking right now to our audience here. You know, you guys might be you're concerned about that. So what I'm going to discuss with you today, I've got a presentation to go over with you today. And the spoiler alert is this, is that there's some good news in the not too distant future. Now, I remember we had talks when there was a lot of uncertainty about COVID. And we talked about the fact that this is a bridge we have to cross and things are going to be good. And sure enough, we got there, right? But those first couple of months were very, very worrisome. So I want you to remember that, you know, of course, we have to look near term, but you know, the real professionals, the real champions, the ones that are able to succeed the most have an ability to look beyond the headlights, to look beyond, you know, what's right in front of them, and to see what's about to happen. So we're going to explore that today. We're going to look at the future before it becomes obvious. We're going to see how we can position ourselves, what we can do right now to take advantage of it, and how we can talk to our customers and our real estate agents with regards to this marketplace and help them, because they're very ill-equipped to do that. Right. So let's start with just to talk for a minute about the housing market. The housing market, I know a lot of people are bashing it right now.
And of course it's slowed down. Of course it's less affordable, but if you buy a home, are you buying that home to live in there for 6 months or 2 months, or, you know, are you living in there on average for several years? I think that we all know what the answer to that is. So when you know, do you get an appraisal on your home every day? Do you say, okay, let me get an appraisal, see what that home's worth today, tomorrow? No, you get an appraisal when it's time to sell it, you know, or time to buy it. So this is a circumstance where I think that we have to just understand what the media is trying to accomplish and take a look at where we're going here. So I firmly believe that a year from now, values will be higher than what they are today. Doesn't mean in the interim, we couldn't see some movement or some volatility, but we will be in a situation where a year from now, values will be higher. And certainly 3 or 4 or 5 or 7 years from now, they'll be much higher than where they are today. So we're going to discuss that. So what's nice about this market is it's a lot more of a normal market. It's just that, you know, the recency factor is we can't remember that quickly what a normal market feels like. It's okay to negotiate price. You know, you don't have to give the seller $100,000 more than they're asking. What we've experienced for a while is abnormal. So mm-hmm. a move back to normal isn't a bad thing. A move back to normal just means that there could be opportunities that we didn't have. And now moving forward, that means that we'll be able to take advantage of those. Like, it could be your forever home, maybe, but it doesn't have to be your forever mortgage or your forever loan. You're going to have opportunities to refinance that. So what's driving the housing market right now? Mortgage rates have a lot to do with it, right? So what's driving mortgage rates? I mean, most people don't even know what drives mortgage rates. You can ask people in our profession. They'll tell you the Fed. They'll tell you Fannie Mae. They'll tell you that. What they don't understand it. So let's understand what drives mortgage rates. It's inflation. If you understand this concept, you will know more than 99% of your competition. So inflation drives mortgage rates. And here's the reason why. So let's assume that we look at this through a different lens, not the lens of a consumer, not the lens of a mortgage professional, not the lens of a realtor, but let's look at it through the lens of a lender. And when you're looking at this from the lender's perspective, make believe you're the lender and you're lending out money. So you have a fund and you're lending out the mortgage money. So just round numbers, let's say you do a mortgage for me and that mortgage is a $400,000 mortgage and it's a fixed rate, which is like 90%+ of loans out there. So the payment you're going to receive from me is $2,000 a month. And that's going to be in effect for a long time. So you get your check for $2,000 this month. You go out and you get a shopping list of goods and services, and you get everything on that list with the $2,000. Next month, you get a check from me and you do the same thing. But over time, you start to discover that, hey, you know what? I can't get everything on that list. I have to leave a few things off because as inflation rises, it makes the things on that list cost more. So mm-hmm. you're still getting a check from me. It still says $2,000, just doesn't buy what $2,000 used to buy. So inflation is eroding the buying power that you were receiving on that fixed payment that you were getting. Now, when inflation is very low, like we've been accustomed to, that erosion is very small. You know, you hardly feel it. But inflation's gone from a little above 1% to over 8% on a year-over-year basis. So what does that mean? Your buying power is evaporating more rapidly. So you have to leave a lot more things off that list more quickly than before. Now, you can't do anything about that loan you gave me. Sorry, I've got a fixed rate. I'm done, right? But mm-hmm. on future loans that you are going to be issuing, what you have to do is figure out a way to protect yourself, because you're going to continue to do mortgages for people. The thing of it is that you realize that your buying power is going to evaporate more rapidly. So the way to protect yourself is to start at a higher perch or a higher payment that you receive to offset the more rapid rate of erosion. So the next time you do another $400,000 mortgage, you don't want to receive $2,000 a month. You might want to receive $2,300, $2,400, $2,500 a month. The only way to do that is to charge a higher rate of interest. And that's exactly what you're seeing today. You're seeing lenders having to offset that more rapid rate of erosion through higher inflation by charging a higher rate so they can net the same amount of buying power over time. That's it. So if we know that inflation drives mortgage rates, well, what drives inflation? Let's take a look. So we're going to talk today about things like recession and real estate and interest rates. So we mentioned inflation. So what is inflation anyway? Very simple. The definition of inflation is too many dollars chasing too few goods. When more people want to buy that have money and the goods are more scarce, prices get bid higher. And you've seen that happen in real estate, for example, over the last couple of years. Too many buyers, that's too many dollars. Too few homes or too little inventory, and prices just got bid up. So what does the Fed do? What's the Fed's role? So here comes the Fed. The Fed comes in and they says, well, we want to kill inflation. We want to fight inflation. Now, how do they start to do that? They hike interest rates. Pretty blunt instrument, but they hike interest rates. And what does that do? So what does hiking interest rates do? And interest rates on what? They don't hike interest rates on mortgages. They hike the Fed funds rate. Now, the Fed funds rate, here's what it affects. Credit cards, car loans, personal loans, home equity loans. So as that borrowing cost goes up, when the borrowing cost goes up, people borrow less. Now, borrowing money actually creates money out of thin air, right? So if I don't have the money to buy a car, I can create that money by borrowing it. So you add money to the system. So the Fed wants to take money out, so they want to discourage borrowing. But you know, when the Fed does this hiking, it's not just individuals, it's corporations. And here's where the big money is. It's commercial and industrial loans. I'm going to build that factory for $300 million. Well, maybe that made sense to do that when the Fed funds rate was at zero. And now maybe I'm paying 2% above that. So maybe I'm paying 2%. Sure, I'll build that factory with 2% interest. But hold on a second. The Fed currently at, let's call it 2.25%, 2.5% is where the Fed funds rate is now. In 8 days from now, that will be 3 to 3.25%. And then on November 2nd, maybe they push that to 4%, or maybe we wind up going higher than 4%. Now I'm paying 2% above that. So, wow, I'm paying 6 or 7% where before I was paying 2. It may not make sense for me to borrow that $300 million with that exorbitant cost that's been added to it. The economics don't make sense anymore. And that's what the Fed wants to do. So the Fed hikes rates and borrowing slows, so it takes money out of the system. But what also happens is that banks now can offer you more money to save. So I want you to think about this. When you used to go to the bank, not too long ago, 6 or 8 months ago, what rate of interest were you being offered? I don't know, 0.0, nothing. So you didn't have that incentive to save. And it's been psychologically proven that human beings, if they receive less than a 2% rate of interest, they'd rather spend it than save it. They'd also maybe think about doing speculative investments as opposed to saving it. So now that you can get a higher rate of interest and going higher, what the Fed's saying is now banks pay people more. So when the Fed hikes, interest rates go up on bank deposits, money comes out of the system and people save it instead of spending it. And that's what the Fed's trying to do. They've also heard so much about the supply chain. And as things are starting to improve, more goods come on the market. So now you have inflation coming down because you don't have too many dollars chasing too few goods. There's more balance. So inflation comes much lower to a more natural state. Now that said, some news that we just reported on in this morning's update is there's a potential rail workers strike that we hope doesn't come to be Friday at midnight. Let's hope that they can resolve this thing because rail accounts for like 30% of the transportation of goods. We need this like a hole in the head, right? Prices are tough enough. Goods are, you know, not plentiful enough. So now could you imagine a rail strike and could you imagine all the problems? So let's just pray that this thing doesn't get out of hand here. It's kind of, in my humble opinion, a cruel thing at this time. This is not what this country needs right now, but let's hope it happens in a good way. I mentioned that inflation drives mortgage rates, and here you can see it in action. So here's inflation, the bottom line here, but it's this like kind of pink line. And then you got the blue line, which is mortgage rates. So as inflation rises, well, what do mortgage rates do? They rise. As inflation falls, the mortgage rates fall. And you can see this pattern repeat itself, except that when the Fed said, hey, we're going to artificially fix the market. And you probably recall that from March of 2020 to about January, February of 2022, the Fed was buying mortgage-backed securities in large quantity. And what they did was they kind of fixed mortgage rates pretty stable around 3% for a 30-year fix. And you can see that here. Now, those of you that are subscribers to MBS Highway, you know, Megan, Dan, and I, we were talking about the fact that when inflation started going up, we started creating charts and showing you that mortgage rates have to go up here. So we have to be very, very careful because mortgage rates are going to go up because they follow inflation. And the Fed was artificially holding them back. Well, once the Fed took their artificial hold off, well, what did mortgage rates do? What they always do, follow inflation. As inflation went up, mortgage rates went up. When inflation dipped, mortgage rates dipped. They went back up, mortgage rates went back up. They dipped again, mortgage rates dipped. So we continue to see, and today, with hotter than expected inflation news this morning on CPI, mortgage rates obviously not liking that. So mortgage rates follow inflation. And you've seen this. You've seen when the Fed hikes rates, mortgage rates come down. Well, why is that? Well, because if the market believes that the Fed is being serious about fighting inflation, then the market sees past that and says, oh, well, that means inflation is coming down, so mortgage rates should come down. The problem is, though, is that the Fed doesn't really have a good handle on things, and they admit that. I mean, could you imagine the head of our Federal Reserve, the chairman, Jerome Powell, probably the most powerful man in the financial world, says that he doesn't understand inflation. Not a comforting feeling. So let's understand it. And maybe Jerome Powell would have benefited from looking like something like this. How do you calculate inflation? Well, don't look at this and roll your eyes. I'm going to explain this to you. It's going to become very easy to understand. This simply tells you what the inflation rate has been on a monthly basis, each individual month. Okay, so when you count the most recent 12 months of data, you get a year-over-year inflation. That kind of makes sense, right? So today we got the inflation data for the month of August, a little bit of a lag, you know, so whatever, a little less than 2 weeks, we had to wait for the August data to come in. So we got that today, and it was up 0.1% for August. But if you take this reading and go back for the last 12 months, including August, so you go back September of 2021, to August of 2022, you add all these numbers up, maybe account for a little rounding and compounding, you get that 8.3% inflation rate. That's where it comes from. So that's where inflation is right now. Now, in a month from now, we are going to get the reading for September. That's going to replace the September of 2021 reading. So if it's lower than 0.4%, the year-over-year inflation comes down. If it's higher than 0.4%, the year-over-year inflation will go up. Now, it's hard to say where that'll fall. Hopefully, it'll be down a little bit. We'll see inflation continue to come down. But notice what happens starting October. When we get the October data, it'll be easy to see inflation fall quite a bit. Look, we had 0.1% for August. If we got that kind of a reading in October, well, then inflation would drop year over year by 0.8%, okay? And all these readings here, as you could see, the remainder of 2021 into early 2022, there are so many high readings that it's going to be, in my opinion, somewhat easy to see inflation come down a lot. Mm-hmm. Now, what did we learn? When inflation comes down a lot, what will happen to mortgage rates?
Mortgage rates
come down a lot. Yes, that's correct, Kevin. So what we'll be seeing is we'll be seeing lower and lower mortgage rates, which tells you that pretty much every loan that has been done over the past 3 or 4 months and every loan that will be done over the next few months is going to refinance. And can I also mention that I believe fourth quarter of this year or first quarter of next year, sometime during that period, mortgage rates will move back down under 5%. Now, why is that important? Do you know that 50% of all mortgage rates that are in existence today are still rates above 4%? So you're going to have lots more refinance activity, and home buyers, they're going to feel a lot better when mortgage rates start with a 4 on it. So there's a lot of good news coming. Now we're going to get some Fed hikes in 8 days from now. We're going to have 75 basis point hike November 2nd, probably another 75. So the Fed will do all it will can to fight inflation. But unfortunately, for some parts of the economy, that's going to lead us, if we're not there already, into a recession. Because that's what the Fed always does. They hike, and then you see these shaded areas, that's a recession. So let's go back even 70 years. Every single time the Fed has a hiking cycle, it brings the economy into a recession. So we want to be careful, because here's where we are. And if we're not in a recession already, we will definitely be in recession-like conditions. Now, there's something else that you probably have heard, is that our yield curve is inverted. So what's that mean? Okay, well, a normal yield curve simply means this. We know that if I'm going to tie money up, that means it's riskier, right? That means less time I have access to the money, more opportunities can be missed. So there's a risk inherent with tying my money up and locking it away. So if I'm going to lock it up for a longer period of time, wouldn't you want a better return or a more attractive return to compensate you for taking on the greater risk of not having access to your money for a longer period of time? And that's what normally happens. The shorter the time you put your money away, the less interest that you receive, but the longer you get more interest. Okay, that's a good thing. But when the two-year treasury, like it is today, is yielding a much higher rate than a longer-term maturity than a 10-year, that's abnormal. Why does that happen? Well, it's an indication that the economy is sick. It's an indication that the longer-term rates, which are concerned about inflation, are not thinking that inflation is going to last that much longer. And the shorter-term rates, which are more attached to the Fed, are thinking that the Fed has done too much and are hiking us too high and slowing the economy down too much. And it's right. Now, when the two-year, this takes the 10-year treasury and subtracts the two-year. So since the 10-year should normally be higher, it should be a positive number. But when the two-year is higher than the 10-year, it's a negative number and you see it in red. And notice when it's in red here and it's an inverted yield curve, you get a recession. Again, recession, again, recession, again, recession, again, recession. There's a little one here which led to a recession. And here's where we are now. And we're either in or going to be in a recession, folks. Now, some people will say, I don't think we're in a recession because the unemployment rate's so low. In fact, this is a Fed governor. And Fed governors vote every single year. Only 12 members of the Fed vote. Governors vote every year. So this gentleman, his name is Chris Waller, he's an important guy. But yet he says, I can't see a recession with a 3.7% unemployment rate. Well, maybe he should look at this chart. Because what you could see for the last 100 years is that that is precisely when you get recessions. You don't get recessions starting when the unemployment rate is high. Recessions begin when the unemployment rate reaches its lowest level and starts to turn higher. You could see with 100% accuracy over and over and over and over and over again, every time. And here's where we are now. Doesn't take a genius to see we're near the end of the cycle. So why does that happen? Well, okay, pick any of these. Times are good. So what do you get? People are hiring. And that brings the unemployed into the workforce and the unemployment rate goes down. So we see unemployed start to work, unemployment rate comes down, things are good. But when things eventually slow down and now you have not enough work for those people, you unfortunately make adjustments and you have to let those people go. So they join the ranks of the unemployed and the unemployment rate starts to tick up a little bit. When the unemployment rate starts to tick up, it's because those people are now without a job. But those folks change their spending habits, don't they? If they've lost their job, they're probably not going out to dinners as much, vacations as much, buying, you know, luxury items as much. And the businesses that used to get their business, they feel a slowdown. And that's when the economy really starts to turn and you get that recession-like feeling and you get that higher unemployment rate while you're in the recession. It happens every time.
Right. So the other thing too about unemployment, isn't it? A trailing indicator.
It is a trailing indicator, correct.
So it happens when now, it's not reflected in today's unemployment rate.
It does lag a little bit, that's correct. So when we see the Fed and the Fed's view of things, the Fed has a very hard time seeing past what's right in front of it. Now, here's Jerome Powell, and he thinks we're in for a soft landing, means avoiding a recession. Because the water's calm here, it doesn't mean that looking ahead that you won't see, you know, rougher times ahead. Okay, so let's say you agree that we're either in or about to enter a recession in the pretty near future. What's that mean for us? So one thing it means is that mortgage rates decline. And you have history of that. You could see in the last recession, mortgage rates dropped by about 1%, then went down more. The previous by about 1% and went down more. Again, about 1% dropped more. Here about 2% and dropped more. Here 5%. You could see mortgage rates drop during and after recessions. So let's understand that that's part of why we think interest rates are coming down on mortgages and why the future for the mortgage rate industry looks better. But what about housing? because the media is going to tell you this. The media is going to say, forget it. You know, housing, they're already bash housing all the time anyway, but they're talking about the fact that there's going to be a crash and the recession is going to exacerbate that, right? But if you look at history, that would disagree. As you could see, in the last 60 plus years, during and after recessions, home values do well. Why? Because interest rates are very cooperative and help. There was one time it didn't work, but it wasn't that the recession started the housing bubble. It was the housing bubble that actually led us into the recession. Now, like anything else, this occurred because of supply and demand. Builders in 2006 built way too much. There was more homes built in 2006 than even through today than at any time in our history. Never built more homes. So builders went crazy. But at the exact same time, households being formed were at a very low point. And they really dropped in 2006. And that's because when you look at the median age of a first-time homebuyer is 33 years old. So that 33-year-old in 2006 was born in 1973. And birth rates declined sharply in 73, 74, 75, 76, 77. Why did that occur? Well, abortions were made legal in 1973. So naturally birth rates dropped. Now, before anything is crazy here, I'm not advocating plus or for or against. I'm not talking about that. I'm just giving you, cause and effect. Why were there less household formations? Well, because 33 years before that, less people were born. Why were less people born? Because abortions were then legal. And that changed the amount of births occurring. So we're just giving you what the progression of events were to explain to you why that phenomenon occurred. Now, birth rates started to pick up later on. And that's why the housing market, like in 2011, started to pick up steam because demand became greater. So household formations, by the way, what is that? That's when you have, let's just say there's a family living in a home. And so one of the people comes of age and they move out and they get their own place. Now the family still lives in the home. The remaining family members still live there. So they didn't vacate a dwelling, but now the same family, instead of occupying one dwelling, is occupying two. A formation could also occur with a couple living in a home and they decide to, whatever reason, split up. One person leaves and gets their own place. One person remains behind. So the same couple, but now instead of one dwelling, they're occupying two. Those are called household formations. That's demand. Supply comes from builders building homes. Now, in these environments, people crawl from out of the woodwork. And here are opportunists. And Grant Cardone, very, very smart man. He's an opportunist. And he wants to sell tickets to his events and he wants to make you terrified so you buy tickets for him because he's going to save you. So he says on August 11th, a little over a month ago, don't buy a home unless you can afford to waste money. And then he goes on in his article. You can pull up the article. You can read it. And this is essentially what the article says. These are excerpts from the article. He said, if you bought a home for $100,000 with $5,000 down, 10 years later, the home sells for $200,000. It seems like a big profit. Because you turned $5,000 into $100,000. Consider the cost, 10 years of interest, 10 years of property taxes, real estate fees. Total cost is $86,000. So actual profit of $14,000. And then he does not understand math. I sure would not want Grant Cardone to be my accountant, okay? Because he's not good at math. But he then says that's a 1.4% per year return. So, but Grant, I have one question for you. Where are you going to live? Are you going to sleep on a park bench? Is that where your new residence is, Grant? Because if you were to just rent something modestly at $1,500 a month with a modest 6% increase per year, that's $237,000. So Grant, it's not a 1.4% per year return. That's a 5,000% rate of return on your investment or 500% per year. And again, his math is completely screwy. So I won't even go into how bad, it's so bad, it's like, you can't even talk about it. But this is not the first time Grant Cardone's done this. Let's fact check him. That's the great thing about Google and the internet. You could pull up this article because in 2016 says, buying a house is for suckers. Really? Should you own a home? Well, unless you have $20 million in the bank in cash, you have no business buying a home. Well, let's see how you would have done if you listened to Grant Cardone. Because if you did, then you avoided buying a home for $300,000. And if you would have put 10% down or a $30,000 investment, today, according to the Case-Shiller Home Price Index, which is the best indicator, values have gone up 72%. So you lost your value would have been up to $516,000. So you would have lost out on making $216,000 in profit or a 720% return. Now, maybe Grant Cardone can sell enough tickets so that doesn't matter to him. But to most folks, that makes a big difference. You know, another one is Gary Vee. And I know many of you love Gary Vee, and that's okay. And I think Gary Vee is a really smart guy. I just don't think he's good at housing information. But he, you know, gets on, and you could pull up the podcast, listen to it. It's all on the internet back in 2019, where he hates housing. Very easy to pull up. Just Google it. He says, by the way, you have to remember that every other word is a curse from Gary Vee, but that doesn't make false things true because you curse every other word. So here's, without all the curses, he doesn't think the American dream should be buying a home. It's full of whatever. It's a bad use of upfront capital. It ties you up. It's not smart. He's pissed that he owns a home. So Gary, why? Why would you be pissed at yourself? But he still owns a home though, right? He's going to rent in perpetuity. He'll never buy a new home. He'd rather have a Lambo because you could show it. I mean, the people listen to Gary Vee, right? So what if you listen to him? So back in 2019, if you said, I'm going to buy a $400,000 home, but no, I'm not going to do it because Gary Vee said don't, and he's pissed that he buys a home, and you would have put 10% down, it's a $40,000 investment. Case-Shiller home price index up 48% since then. So the home today would be worth $592. So by listening to Gary Vee, it cost you. He cost you $192,000 in profit or 480% return. So, you know, he's not doing too good on his NFTs either. But, you know, then you have, of course, Diana Olick, who is the poster child for being public enemy number one with individuals who have lost nothing but tens of thousands of dollars and hundreds of thousands of dollars by listening to her advice. So Diana Olick has, for the past 10 years, put out literally, and you see her on every day bashing housing. Three times a day they bring her on. And what does she do? Everything that she does is bashing housing. So she's been doing this for 10 years, by the way. Now, of the literally hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of bad press stories about housing and bashing housing stories, I want to just give you a few. So let's just go back to 2015 when she says, we're in a bubble larger than 2006. As she said that 7 years ago. Okay. Now, if you were thinking about buying a $300,000 home, but you said, I'm not going to, I'm listening to Diana. Well, you missed out on that home appreciating in that 1 year, 5.1% or $15,000. Now, next year, you think she would say, oh, I'm sorry, I cost you money? No. She just says, well, we're in a new housing bubble. Oops. But values went up the following year by another $17,000. So what does she say the next year? She says, don't buy a home because it doesn't build wealth. She said, don't buy a home. Exact words, doesn't build wealth. Can you show me one person since 2017 who in the last 5 years has not built wealth in real estate? Can you just show me one home that hasn't appreciated? And that 1 year, prices went up another 20,000. And then in 2018, she says it's better to rent than to buy. Well, can you name one person over the past 4 years who has been better off renting? Just show me one. And that year, prices went up another 14,000. So in the middle of 2019, she issues this proclamation where she says, hold on, stop everything. You better ditch your contract. Don't buy a home because the housing market's about to shift in a bad way. That sounds pretty imminent and scary, except for the remainder of the year, prices went up another $15,000. So at the end of the year, 2019, instead of saying, I'm sorry, she issues her forecast for 2020. And she said, it's going to be really hard on the housing market. I guess it's only hard if you didn't buy a home because prices went up another $61,000. So a year ago, she now gives her call of the year, that the housing boom is over. But since then, values have gone up another $80,000. So she literally has cost people $250,000 on a modest $300,000 home. I shudder to think on the more expensive homes, how much money she has cost people. So we know, don't listen to the media. Look, we want to build wealth. That's what you want to do for your customers. And how do you measure net worth? By taking all of your assets and subtracting from that all your debts. That gives you your net worth figure. So to be in the top 1% in the United States, your net worth needs to be $10.8 million. It's a lot. This is all according to Kiplinger's. But how about the top 2%? $2.5 million net worth. That's all your assets minus your liabilities. How about the top 5%? $1 million. The top 10%? $800,000. And how about the top 50%? You need a $500,000 net worth in order to do that. Except one thing that Kiplinger's also said that they discovered in this study, 2/3 of all net worth on average comes from home equity. You want to be wealthy, You need to buy real estate. It's that simple. All these other people that want to hold you down and keep you from creating wealth, they'll put all their news stories to try and sell whatever they're selling, tickets, advertising, books, whatever they're trying to sell. But what you want to make sure that you do is you understand that over the long term, if you want to build wealth, you got to be in real estate. All right. So we know the media gets it wrong. So how do we get this right? What are the things that Megan and Dan and Dan and myself, Jake, what do we do every day when we kind of put out our daily videos? We look at things so that you can better explain it. And right now, the amount of households being formed in the United States is 1.7 million households a year. That's demand in housing. So is that number odd? Well, it's been kind of around the average for that as well. So it's a good number because you can see it's been near this number for a while. Now, here's your COVID, you know, crazy moves, but this will cancel each other out and be around the same level. And you can see this goes all the way back to about 2015. So we have been in this demand of about 1.7 million homes per year. Okay. Now, what about supply? How do you measure supply? You don't measure it like Diana Olick does by looking at housing starts because that's a shovel in the ground. I can't live in a housing start. I need a completed home. So how many homes are being completed in the United States right now? 1.4 million. But of those, they're replacing about 100,000 homes that get rebuilt, remodeled, redone, destroyed. So net, we're getting about 1.3 million new homes, but we need 1.7. We're still short 400,000 homes a year, folks. So it is a very tight inventory situation still. And you can see it here, low inventory. People talk about a housing bubble. Well, this is a housing bubble. 3.8 million units for sale. We have a third of that in inventory right now. This is existing home inventory. It's a third of what it was. It is the second lowest level we've ever seen. As I'm speaking to you, I just looked up on CNBC. Diana Olick is spewing her poison right now. You can see her face already. She is rejoicing in the negative news that she's giving. She's doing it right now, live in real time with us, folks. So almost on cue, Diana Olick doing her thing. Several times a day this happens. So when you take a look here at the low level of inventory and you say, okay, it's a third of what it was, but population has grown by 14 million more households, not people, households in the United States. So 14 million more households fighting for a third of the homes that were in inventory. Now, a big story that's out there is rising existing home inventory. Man, how can you argue with this? This looks bad, right? Well, inventory is definitely rising. And we know that, you know, demand is one thing, but this is, you know, supply, right? This is your inventory. It's rising. That's probably a bad thing. But you need perspective. Now, Patrick Bet-David's a friend of mine, and I've been on his show, and, you know, actually June of 2021 debated with him. He didn't think the housing market was doing good, and that brought up a lot of good points. Sure enough, you know, we know what housing's done since then. So, you know, I'll leave it at that. And, you know, you can see for yourself what prices have done since then. So it was a good decision to buy. But he showed this exact chart and said that, you know, inventory is moving up. But what he didn't do was give you perspective to show you that if you look at the last 10 years, this is what he showed. And it looks in itself like inventory is rising, but it does that every single year over and over and over and over and over again. Why? Because it's a normal cycle. You see, remember when you were a kid and you had a new kid come to class in the middle of the school year? Well, kids are tough. And it's not easy for that new kid in class to make friends in the middle of the school year. Parents know this. They want their kid to start at the beginning of the school year. And by doing so, that means they have to be in their home during June, July, and August, which means they had to put their old home up for sale April, May, June, July, which is why every April, May, June, July, inventory moves up every single year over and over and over again. They call it the spring home buying season. It's not because flowers are in bloom. It's because you want your kid to start at the beginning of the school year. Now, I did tell you that there's 1.3 million homes in inventory, and that's what the media says. And they'll tell you right now, oh, it's a 3-month supply. But they're wrong, because what they don't tell you is that included in this 1.3 million is homes that are under contract. Wait a minute. Is your realtor going to say to you, hey, let's go check out this house. They're closing next week. They already got their mortgage, but for shits and giggles, let's go look at this new home. Let's hope that sold. No, it's not available. What's available? 747,000 homes in inventory. This is a country of 340 million people. there's only 747 homes that are actually available for sale. So it, I'm sorry, it is not a 3-month supply. It's slightly above a 2-month supply, which is really tight inventory. That's why homes that are priced right are selling in 2 weeks. And folks, same look, this is actual existing inventory that's listings. Same cyclical, there's a little COVID distortion here, but the same thing. Now, because prices are up, because rates are up, are we going to get a little inventory build? Sure, but this is about the peak here. And you can see even from record levels, it is, you know, still just slightly above record levels. And a more normal year like 2019, much less inventory, a year that was not affected by COVID. Another thing is 43% of the inventory is under contract. Normal is 25%. And you're going to hear this one too. Big story, CBS Market Watch. Oh man, this sounds bad. Dramatic increase. Foreclosures, filings are up more than 150%. Good Lord, that's really bad, right? They said this, you know, less than 2 months ago. And man, it is up 150%, huh? But from when? From 2020? Oh, you mean the year that you had forbearance and you couldn't do foreclosures? Oh, you mean if you took a year that was more normal? Let's not tell them we're down 40%. Or if you want to compare it to a housing bubble situation, let's not tell them it's down 90%. See, the media won't do that though, right? That's what you have to do. That's what you need to be as an advisor. And that's what separates you from your competition. Now, here's a big one is, okay, affordability. Well, it's not affordable anymore. Can't buy a home. Why? Because it's not affordable. Okay, well, let's take a look at that. So in 2021, last year, if you were going to buy a home and take out a $400,000 mortgage, and let's pick a rate and say 3.5%, your payment's $1,800 a month. Now, if you take a look at the averages, according to the data from Fannie or Freddie, on average, people's income for something like this was two income earners earning between $4,000 and $5,000 a month. So let's call it $9,000 a month. This year, since values have gone up 18%, I got to borrow more money. I got to borrow 18% more to buy a similar home, which means that's going to cost me more because the mortgage amount's greater. In addition to that, the rate's higher. So my payment, let's call it $1,000 a month more. That's a lot. And that's where the media stops. Unaffordable, $1,000 a month more. But what they don't tell you is this, that incomes have gone up. How much? Well, ADP, which tells you based upon 25 million employees in their study, said that if you stayed at your job, your income went up 7.6%. If you switched, it went up 16%. Now more people stay. So when you blend these together, you have a 9% increase, which means that your income went up $800 a month. So you mitigated this by quite a bit. But let's be fair here, because these are the averages for a family. Gasoline's gone up, food's gone up, services has gone up. So listen, there is no question about it. People are having a tougher time because even though their income's gone up, prices have moved up a lot faster than their income and costs have moved up faster than their income. But again, you know how the Fed was on that going over Niagara Falls and they thought it was calm water because they didn't see ahead? Let's not be like that. Let's look ahead. So as we look ahead, what do we see? We know that next year, your income is going to go up too. Over 90% of mortgages are fixed. So A, your payment's fixed. B, you probably will refinance and reduce your payment. But let's just say you keep your payment fixed. Your income in 2023 will totally have washed this differential. So why do some people really succeed when there's adverse times? Because they see the opportunity. What's my opportunity now? I can actually negotiate and get a better deal on a home. I know that I can take this mortgage out and refinance it to a lower rate. I know my income is going to go up and the payment's going to seem a lot simpler. And when values go up next year and the year after and the year after and the year after, I'm going to be sitting pretty instead of the alternative of renting. Now, a show that I'm on where I do the cover for it is American Dream. I do the first 5 minutes and that goes out to every market nationwide where I talk about things like this. But then it gets taken over by people who have territories and it's shown on CNBC, it's shown on Bloomberg, it's shown on a lot of different networks. Well, I have no affiliation with them, but what I want you to understand is that the people that are doing this are crushing it. So I've got a QR code if you want to participate in it. I'm just giving you an idea here. You can own a market where the show airs. And not only does it give you great exposure and people get to see you, but think about this. Here's how a lot of people are using it. And this is why I bring it up because I think it's brilliant. A lot of the people on there, they're going to their real estate agents and they're saying, hey, would you be on with me? And we could feature a listing that you have or a listing that you want to get. wow, you know, I don't have to tell you folks in California, but if it's a $3 million listing, you don't think that that real estate agent's going to want to do business with you if you can get them to get more listings and get them featured. So I want to tell you that I don't know exactly how much it costs, but if you do the QR code and you do it, but only serious inquiries, and you have to apply, you're not going to automatically get it. If there's a territory open and you qualify, it's about $1,000 to $2,000 a month, depending on the territory. So just, you know, make sure you can afford it, make sure you want to do it, and then you could apply and see if it's available. What's our housing forecast? Rents are going to continue to rise, 12 to 14% on new, 8% on renewals. We see mid-single digits, between 4 and 5% appreciation. So is that bad? Well, it's less than 18%, but it's not bad. Let's do the math lesson here. Let's go back to class. Not just so you can learn it, so you could teach your customers and teach your realtors. $400,000 purchase price, just as an example, 10% down payment is a $40,000 investment. That's your cash investment. 4% appreciation is a $16,000 profit. A $16,000 profit on a $40,000 investment is a 40% return. Now, you know why you need real estate to create wealth. So what about the people saying, hey, you know, what about renting right now? I'm a little worried. Well, let's take a look and let's make a ridiculous example. Okay. Some of you do non-QM and some of you hesitate to do non-QM because you can't utter the interest rate and you feel that your customer is going to get scared by it. Well, show them this. If the purchase price, again, do it at any purchase price. This is just giving you examples here. $400,000 purchase price, 10% down is a 360 loan. Now, I know your rates are a lot cheaper than this, but let's just pick a rate of 7.5, or say it's a non-QM. And I know a lot of them like 6.9 or something, but let's just say the rate's 7.5. And they think they're going to be in the home for 9 years. Well, if the property taxes go up 2% per year, let's count that. That's a negative. So we're going to give all the bad stuff here. And then you should budget on a $400,000 home about $166 a month in repair costs. That's the average. So even though you're not spending it, let's budget it and count it against you. And then how about the cost to sell? I don't have to worry about that if I'm renting. So based on the future appreciated value, let's take 6% of it. And how much is it going to appreciate? Well, if you take the 63-year historical average, let's call it roughly 4.5%. Okay, now, but how about renting? Now, you know this, a $400,000 home is going to rent for more than $3,000 a month. But let's say you know the landlord and they're saying, hey, come on, I'll give you a break. I'm only going to charge you $2,750. And while the rest of the world is going up at 8% a year, I'll limit your rental increases to 6. That sounds like a sweet deal to me. Maybe you should rent, right? So let's compare. If you were to buy, your payment's $3,500. If you're renting, it's $2,700. Oh, man, that's easy. I'd save all that money. Maybe I should rent. But the rent goes up. And take a look at that rent going up over the 9 years. You know, by the fifth year, it's about a break even in monthly, but the overall is about a break even over the 9 years. But that's not the whole point of it. That's just one aspect. You know, you save a lot more than that. Why? Because if you look at your mortgage payment on principal and interest, it's $2,500 a month. Now, that's made up of principal and interest. You all know where the interest goes, right? You all know. It goes to the lender, right?
But everyone always forgets about the principal part.
Yeah. Where does the principal go, everyone? Whose money is that? Whose money is that, Kevin?
That's yours.
That's correct. It's the borrower's own money. So let me give you this example to make it clear. Imagine I had cash sitting in my left-hand pocket. I take it out of my left-hand pocket and I move it over and I put it in my right-hand pocket. Is it still my money? Obviously, it's just in a different location. Now, when you make your mortgage payment, the principal portion of that payment is in your checking account. When the lender cashes it, it's an equity in your home because it reduces your mortgage amount. It's still your money. It's just in a different location. And the reason to bring it up is because it's a lot of money. In this case, it's $41,000. But how about appreciation on that home? I mean, how much could it be? It's only 4.49%, we said, right? So I mean, how much is that going to amount to? 4%? Is that a lot? We have to do this because people can't do it in their head. Compound interest, as Albert Einstein said, it's the eighth wonder of the world. And in this case, it's $194,000. That's why you got to show it to them. And then your tax break. And now decrease that by the future value, $593,000 to 6% for cost to sell. You can see that over the 9 years, in this crazy example, we threw the kitchen sink of negative things and made it the sweetest deal on renting, the kitchen sink of negative things on buying, you are still better off by $205,000. I bet you that would be eye-opening. And even after 6 years, it's 93. Even after 4 years, would you throw away $40,000? And in this crazy example, what you would say to the customer is, hey, look, if you're going to be there less than 2 years, rent. But if you're going to be there longer than 2 years, even with things as crazy as they are, even if you never refinance that 7.5% rate to a lower rate, you're much better off buying. And then co-brand it with them. Now, here's an area, you're looking for more ways to do business, right? So here's an area that you really need to consider is investment properties, because people can make a lot of money. And do you know that right now, one out of every 6 to 7 transactions in investment, 15% of the market is investment properties, but your realtor probably isn't tapping into it. And maybe you're not tapping into it. And maybe that's because you don't have the tool to do it, which is why at MBS Highway, we created this tool. It's the only thing it didn't exist. So we said, well, let's just create it. Just like a lot of the things that we do at MBS, how we create things that don't exist. Now, here's an example. Purchase price, let's say $500,000, the loan amount with 20% down. It's an investment property. It's $400,000, 6% rate. They're going to own it for 9 years. So you got your cost to buy, and I went high here. Your repair cost estimate, which we're going to put in there. Your property tax is increasing, and your cost to sell, 6% of the appreciated value. Now, the forecast going forward for the next 9 years is a little over 5% appreciation. So you could get $3,400 to rent. And while the rest of the world is getting 8% increases a year, you like the client, you only give them 6% increase. And then there's a vacancy rate that you have to apply to this, right? Because not going to be occupied full time. So we'll go with a reasonable vacancy rate of 4%. Your cash flow is a little bit negative in year one, but over the 9 years, you're going to make $52,000 by doing this. And when you look at your cash flow based upon what your cash outlay is for down payment and closing costs, you're going to make 45% cash on cash return. But folks, this is the tip of the iceberg, because now you've got your appreciation, you factor in your amortization, and now what you've got is your overall flow. And you can see you're going to get $730,000 between your rental income and your appreciation. You deduct your expenses and interest in property taxes, insurance, repairs, closing costs to buy and sell of $400,000. And you made a very nice profit of $329,000. You invested $100,000. You made a 329% return. Now, you can't just divide that by 9. You have to figure out a compounded yearly rate. Compounded yearly, it's 17.6%. Anybody wish they can get 17.6% compounded year after year? This is why real estate creates wealth. This is why you need to consider this. And given that you'll have the only tool of its kind, you can help realtors and customers see the opportunity that exists. Folks, we just introduced this a couple of weeks ago, and people are losing their minds crushing it with this tool. Now, here's another idea. Again, I'm going to give you ideas. Talk to every realtor you have and say, before you go on your next listing appointment, let me help you. Let me give you an AVM. And we do this at MBS Highway and give you the AVM. You don't want them going to Zillow with this estimate, because then Zillow is going to bombard them with their mortgage salespeople and their realtors. So keep them off Zillow. This way you could show them that, show them the value, and then do their work for them. Hey, rather than you go out and spending an hour with comps, let me do all that work for you and show you where they are in an interactive map and show you the trends in sales price and square foot in the amount of units sold. And then, of course, the real estate report card, which you know we have and we've been doing forever. And this real estate report card is, I think you're crazy if you talk to a customer without looking at this, because what do you want to talk about? You want to talk about rate? You want to talk about qualifying? Your mobile device could do that, and it could do more accurately and cheaper and faster than we all can. But it can't do this. Your competitor's not going to say, how does it stack up to other parts of the country? What's the price per square foot and median home price in your zip code? What does appreciation look like historically? And what's the forecast? And what does that mean for your value of your home? How much money are you going to make on this home in the next 5 years? What is the inventory situation? What does the demographics of ages look like? What are the renter situation look like? What is demand from formations of households and supply from builders putting up homes look like to you? Is that going to support it? What does affordability look like? Has it changed? What's the income compared to the rest of the country? What's the unemployment rate, and how's the job market look here? Everything your customer wants to know, you're the expert. And then you want to say thank you to your realtor, co-brand it with them. Folks, it is. And how long does it take to do all these things? Less than 5 seconds to do any of them for me. And my typing sucks. It'll take Megan a fraction of that time to do it. Probably you too. Now, okay, the bottom line.
We are at the top of the hour. So we've got to wrap.
I've got 60 seconds left. Right. Sorry. We started a little bit late, and that's why. I know we had some banter at the beginning, and that's what kind of, so I thought we were going for an hour. So what you want to do is grow exponentially. So linear growth is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Exponential is 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64. What's the key to exponential growth? At the end of a week, if you took a penny and doubled it every day, you'd have 64 cents. But what if you started just 1 week sooner? You know how much you'd have? You'd have $81. Okay, well, how about if you started a week before that? You'd have 10,000. If you started a week before that, you'd have 1.3 million. If you started just a couple of days before that, you'd have 5.3 million. And what if you started immediately, right away? You'd have 10.7 million. Folks, the lesson here is that procrastination is a killer. Implement. If you have good ideas, do them. Audrey mentioned this, and that's why I'm doing this. And I want to reiterate the discount that you guys have. You get a $400 discount. Audrey's a CMA graduate. She said how much she learned. Kevin's told you about that. If you want to walk the walk and be smarter than your competition, go to becomecma.com or send an email to Megan at MBS Highway, Megan at MBS Highway, and she will get you a disc. In fact, here's what we're going to do, Megan. You ready for this? We're going to do this on the fly here. If you email Megan at MBS Highway, she's going to take another $200 off this for you. So it'll be $13.97. So that you can't do it here because it'll be $15.97 with this code. You just got to email Megan at MBSHighway.com, M-E-G-A-N, M-E-G-A-N, Megan at MBSHighway.com. And she will take another $200 off this. You're crazy if you don't do it. Now, if you're not on MBS Highway, I don't have for the life of me an understanding as to why, because all this stuff's in there and more. Plus, we'll protect you with your locks. Plus, you get a video every day from us that explains what's happening so you can sound like a pro. It's $200 a month. There are 35,000 members, most of them paying up here. You guys today, because of our relationship with Kevin and Audrey and the show, you could save $80 a month or $800 for the year. At $11.99 for the year. You figure that out. That's less than $100 a month. Again, send an email to Megan at MBS Highway. And if you want to do this today, here's what will happen. Send an email to Megan, and here's what we will do. Now, many of you know List Reports. Many of you know how valuable this product is. We went to List Reports because we admire them. They are helping you do many things. They'll make sure that the realtors you're targeting are performing realtors. If you have, so why waste your time working on trying to make a relationship if they don't do any business? Realtors are out there that you've developed and they're cheating on you with somebody else. You'll be able to know who they are, who they're cheating with, why. So you can talk to them and you can win them back and see what somebody else is doing that you maybe need to be doing. If they do something on social media, you will have automatically posts to engage. So you're working with them on social media. If they get a listing, you can automatically generate open house kits for them and flyers that will automatically be sent to them. Now, it normally costs $275 a month for List Reports for all the tools that I explained. You're going to get it for free for 2 months, for free for 2 months. Why? Because in the next 2 months, we want you to build realtor relationships, do more business so that you can win in this market. We went to them and we asked them to do this. And then we said, what about after that? Instead of spending $275 a month, they'll do it at $199 a month if you want to continue with them, which you probably will starting the third month. There's no obligation to do so the first 2 months. Now, if you're already an MBS Highway member, if you're already a member, then just text your NMLS ID to 714-874-9570, and it'll be cross-checked if you're an MBS Highway member, so don't get cute. And what'll happen is they'll put you on this because we don't want you to miss out saying, oh, I already bought MBS Highway. We got you covered. But otherwise, Megan at MBS Highway gets you that. And if you want to do the combo, Megan, save them another $400 off the combo if they want MBS Highway and CMA with the List Reports add-on for $19.99. But you can only get that. Don't do it with this because that'll give you, even though it's great at saving $1,600, we're going to do it where it saves you $2,000. And Megan at MBSHighway.com. Remember this, don't give up. Your best opportunities are ahead of you. Don't think, oh, the rates have gone up. Other In 1899, this guy, Charles Duell, was the head of the patent office. He said, let's close it because, and I quote, we don't need a patent office. Everything that can be invented has already been invented. Folks, your best opportunities are ahead of you. You helped me make this book a number one bestseller. It's about finding opportunities and doing well with them. And there we go, Audrey. We kind of just went almost exactly an hour from the time that I had, but.
You know what I like about the List Reports, Barry? It's not that I know to find out if my realtors are cheating on me. I find out that they're not cheating on me. They're just slacking right now.
Well, they also, I have List Reports and you get a notification every time they do a listing or they tell you what they're doing. I get emails. So that's a great partnership, Barry. Megan, thank you so much. I'm going to have you, we're going to figure out how to put together a tutorial, a walkthrough of everything you guys have available. And Barry, thank you so much for joining us today.
I just want to say something because somebody said that my math was wrong. Actually, my math is correct. We're really good at math, by the way. What you're not considering is you have to live somewhere. So what are you going to do? You're going to rent? You're going to rent for free? Are you going to live in a tent? You're going to sleep at a park bench? Like you're thinking like Grant Cardone, okay? So think bigger. Our math is correct.
Yeah, at some point I'd like someone to explain to me how Diana Oleg stays employed when she is so wrong so much of the time.
Because what she does is very successful. She's scared. Here's what sells. Sex sells. Diana Oleg is not a sex symbol by any stretch, but fear also sells. So what she is doing is it's called fear porn. That's what she's doing. Fear porn.
Wow.
There's we all learned a new definition today. So
that's right. Exactly. All right. Well, thank you again for everything. And this really ties in with the messaging that we've been getting. We had a great presentation with Dave Stevens last week, and he was of the same mind where we just need to get through the winter and it's going to be brighter on the other side. We're getting there, guys. It cycles just as always. So anyway, and we will see you next Tuesday. We are going to be talking about appraisals next Tuesday. Appraisals, and appraisers. All right. With that, we'll see you then. Thank you again. Bye, guys.
Bye, guys.
Bye, Megan. Bye, Audrey.